Hi everyone! In this video, we'll practice together working with continuous time signals and systems through some simple exercises. I'm Gio, I'm an expert in wireless communications and an assistant professor at UPF in Barcelona. I keep posting theory and tutorial classes on signals and systems, so if you want to get up to speed with the fundamentals of signals and systems and have a limited time, this is the right channel for you. Now let's get started. The first exercise we'll work on today asks us to consider a system with a certain impulse response h of t defined here, and there's three questions we should answer: reasoning whether the system is stable or not, whether the system is causal or not, and determining the output y of t for a certain input x of t. If you're not familiar with the concepts of stability, causality, and on how to calculate the output of a system given the input and the impulse response, I recommend watching the related theory video that I have posted. So let's get started. Let's start by drawing the impulse response h of t. So as you can see, it's a right-sided exponential defined between 2 and 12 in the time domain. The maximum value is 1, and then it decreases down to 1 over e. So let's answer the first question. To answer whether the system is stable or not, we need to calculate the integral of the absolute value of h of t in dt, where h of t is the impulse response of the system. So if the impulse response is absolutely integrable, meaning that this integral is finite, then the system is stable. So if we calculate the integral, this is simply the integral between 2 and 12 of e to minus 0.1 t minus 2 in dt. And this integral can be easily solved and gives us as a result 10 times 1 minus e to minus 1. So this is clearly finite. Therefore, we can conclude that the system is stable. Cool. What about causality? So to determine whether the system is causal or not, we need to see whether h of t is 0 for all negative times. And this is the case because if you just look at the representation, we see that h of t is non-zero only between 2 and 12. So yes, we can conclude that the system is causal. What about part C? We need to determine the output for a certain input x of t, which is an impulse centered at 2. We know that the output can be calculated as the convolution between the input x of t and the impulse response. In this case, the input is delta of t minus 2. We do the convolution between that and the impulse response, and we know that the convolution with an impulse basically shifts the original signal. So in this case, we'll be shifting h by a value of 2, we'll be delaying it. Therefore, the result, which is h of t minus 2, can be written as you see at the bottom right. So can we represent this? What does this look like? Well, it will be the shifted version of h of t. So we can write it in formula, for example, by using step functions. So by basically representing the interval between 4 and 14 as the difference between two step functions, u of t minus 4 minus u of t minus 14. And if we just represent y of t, well, it has the same shape as h of t, but it's shifted by a quantity 2. So same as before, but between 4 and 14. Right, let's move on to the next exercise. So in this case, we have to consider a certain input signal, which is given by the sum of three functions. It's three step functions. And this is fed into a system that has a certain impulse response, h of t, represented here. So without determining the output y of t, we should be able to determine the value of y of 0, meaning the value of the output for t equals 0. We should be able to do this from our knowledge and understanding of signals and systems without having to explicitly calculate y of t. Then there's a bunch of other questions which we will address one by one. So let's start with point A. So we know that y of t, again, is the convolution between x and h. So this is the general formula. So y of 0 can be obtained by just replacing t equals 0. So it's the same integral where we have substituted t equals 0. So that's the expression. So how to determine this value? Well, let's draw h of t, the impulse response. First of all, it's the one we're drawing here in red. So, you know, it's 0, then it's t plus 1 between minus 1 and 0. Then it's t minus 1 between 0 and 1, and then it's 0 again outside of the interval. Right. So we notice that h of t is an odd signal. That means that h of t is equal to minus h of minus t, meaning that if we mirror the signal with respect to the y-axis, then basically it changes its sign, right? So we can use actually this property. So we can rewrite the integral basically as minus the integral of x of tau h of tau d tau. And then it's easy to see that just by replacing x of tau with its expression, which is u of tau minus 2u of tau minus 4 plus u of tau minus 6, we get an integral that, because of linearity, can be calculated as the sum of three different simple integrals. So let's just do that. So if we keep with our calculations, we obtain three integrals, okay? They're all very similar. They are the product of a step function times our impulse response h. And I label these integrals as 1, 2, and 3, so I'll solve them one by one. Again, just recall that this is the expression and the graphical representation for the impulse response. So by knowing that, it's very easy to see that the first integral can be written as minus the integral between 0 and infinity of h of tau. That's because u of tau is non-zero only for positive tau. And this integral is clearly 1/2, because it's minus the area of the red signal between 0 and 1. What about number 2? Well, number 2, again, is the integral between 4 and infinity, this time of the impulse response, and this integral is clearly 0, because in that interval, the impulse response is 0. Same thing for the third term, which is an integral between 6 and infinity. Again, this is 0. So if we sum the three terms, we obtain 1/2. So the value of y of 0 that we were looking for is 1/2, or 0.5. And notice that we have determined this without determining explicitly the whole expression for the output y of t. The second question is about determining the values of t for which y of t is 0. So how to do that? So let's recall again that y of t, the output, is the convolution between the input and the impulse response, which can be written with the convolution integral. And let's recall again the expression for x of t, the input. It's perhaps much easier to answer this question by drawing a graphical representation of the input x of t, or x of tau if we represent it in the variable tau. It's the same. So let's do that. So we start by representing in green u of tau. It's a step function centered at 0. Then we represent minus 2u of t minus 4, or tau minus 4, because it's in the variable tau. This is represented in yellow, and you see it's a negative step function that starts at time 4. And finally, the third term is a u of tau minus 6, is another step function, unitary, but it starts at time 6. So x of tau is going to be given by the sum of these three, which I represent here in light blue, with a solid line. So this is x of tau. So it's 0, then it's 1, then it's minus 1, then it's back to 0, right? Cool. So now that we know that, we want to answer the question. So when is y of t 0? Well, y of t is 0 when this convolution integral is 0. And here I have rewritten the convolution integral with a minus sign, again by exploiting the fact that my h is an odd signal, okay? So h of t minus tau is equal to minus h of tau minus t, but it's the same thing. So I notice that my y of t, or my integral, is going to be 0 if h of tau minus t is such that the red signal, which is h, falls outside of the support of the blue signal, which is x of tau. That then their product is going to be identically 0, so the integral will be 0. And this occurs for values of t smaller than minus 1, meaning when I shift my signal h of tau to the left of the support of the blue signal. Okay, so this is the first set of values for which y of t will be 0. But there are more, obviously. So for example, if on the other hand I push my h of tau minus t all the way to the right, again falling outside of the support of the blue signal, and this happens for t larger than 7 if you notice, then again the integral will be zero. What else? In what other cases does that happen? So if, for example, h of tau minus t falls within an interval where my blue signal is constant, well, then again, because h is a node signal, you will see that the integral of the product will be zero, because the negative and positive parts of tau, they are specular, they have the same but opposite value, so the overall integral, the overall area, would be zero. This occurs when t is between 1 and 3. So when t is between 1 and 3, I shift my red signal such that it falls within the constant interval of the blue one. And there's more. For t equal 5, my signal h of tau minus 5 falls exactly again within a constant interval of the blue signal, so then again the result is zero. So for all these sets of values, I have that my y of t will be zero. The next question is asking for the largest negative value of the output y of t. So how can I determine the largest negative value of y of t, again, without calculating y of t explicitly? Well, okay, notice that this is the expression for y of t, it's minus that integral. So I get the largest negative value when this integral is the largest. And when is that the largest? It's the largest when I shift h of tau such that the positive values of h correspond to the positive values of the blue signal x, and the negative values of h correspond to the negative values of this blue signal x again. So this exactly occurs when t is 4, because when t is 4, h of tau minus 4 is centered exactly where there's a transition of my blue signal, where the signal goes from positive to negative. So in that case, I have the largest negative value, and this value is actually minus 1. You can calculate it because it's the integral of the product between the pink and the blue, and that area is exactly 1. One more question now. So is the system stable? What can we say about stability of the system? So we know that to assess the stability of the system, we should look at whether the impulse response is absolutely integrable. So here I'm drawing the absolute value of the impulse response, h of t, and I see that this integral, the integral of the magnitude or the absolute value of h of t in dt, is 1. So yes, I can say that the system is stable because this value is finite. One more question, is the system causal? Well, to assess causality, we know that we need to see whether the impulse response is non-zero for negative times. And in this case, we see that between minus 1 and 0, the impulse response is non-zero. So we can conclude that the system is not causal. So in this video, you have learned a little bit more about working with continuous time signals and systems. If you haven't done so, I also recommend watching my theory classes to better understand the fundamentals of signals and systems. And of course, more videos are coming, so do subscribe to this channel if you want to know when I upload something new. So see you in the next video.